So here we are going to review some several points on affine transformation. So you may already know some of the points that we will discuss, and you can go fast on the points you already saw, but affine transform is very important for 3D graphics, and sometimes more complex than it appears actually. So it's worth spending some time on it. So first, affine and linear transformations are the most common deformation used in graphics. This transformation can be represented by a matrix, which is a generic way to represent them. And note that these matrices correspond to the Jacobian of the deformation F. As it's quite generic, these matrices can typically be sent as uniform parameters to common shaders in order to move, scale, or rotate a shape in real time. In standard 3D coordinates, considering a point P with coordinate X, Y, and Z, an affine transformation transforms P into P prime with P primes equals L times P plus T, where L is a 3x3 matrix representing the linear part of the transformation, and T is the translation. In homogeneous coordinates, the point P has coordinate X, Y, Z, and 1, and in this case, we can simply write P primes equals A times P, where A is a 4x4 matrix. This matrix A has a block structure with the top left corner expressed by the 3x3 matrix of the linear part, and the column on the top right is the translation, and the bottom row is 0, 0, 0, and the final one in the bottom right. Some specific properties can be directly computed from the matrix of the linear part. Typically, the determinant of L relates to the change of volume implied by this matrix. So if we apply L to a shape, we can know directly how the volume of this shape is going to be modified from the value of the determinant of L. Also, if L transpose times L equals identity, or similarly L transpose is equal to L inverse, then the transformation is an isometry, meaning that it preserves the distances between all points. And we can categorize the affine transformation. First, the translation represented by a vector tx, ty, tz. This is a very simple transformation, but it's not a linear one. The translation can be directly read on a 4x4 matrix. Then scaling, that can be fully described by three parameters, Sx, Sy, Sz, and has a diagonal matrix. And quite often, we can consider Sx equals Sy equals Sz, and then we have an homogeneous scaling, only with S. Third, the rotations. So unfortunately, 3D rotations are complex to parameterize, and there is actually several possible representations that we will describe later. Note that rotations are part of the isometry. And finally, although we often forget about it, there is shearing transformation. Actually, shearing transforms a square into a diamond pattern, and there is lots of possible shearings between each pair of coordinates. Usually, shearing is avoided. We don't apply it explicitly, and we would like to avoid it. But note that the determinant of a shearing transform is 1, which means that it actually preserves the volume of the deformed shape, but it's not an isometry, as the distances are modified. And now a few words about rotations. So 3D rotations are transformations that have internally 3 degrees of freedom, but as we said previously, there is not a unique way to represent rotation. And actually, none is fully perfect on all points. So first, we can represent rotation as matrix. So this is a linear operation, and general rotation are expressed by the 9 component of a 3x3 matrix. Rotation matrix have the properties that R transpose times R equals identity, and that their determinant is plus 1. So they are isometry and not symmetry. Using matrix representation is computationally convenient as it fits in the general matrix representation system, and matrices can be multiplied together to model composition and use the matrix vertex product to apply the transformation on a vector. However, they require 9 components that are not meaningful to interpret. If you see a 3x3 matrix, you cannot easily figure out what kind of rotation it is. And as rotation only requires 3 independent values, it also means that the 9 components are highly redundant to describe this object. The second approach is the use of Euler angles, which describe the rotation with 3 angles corresponding to 3 basic rotations around specific axes that are decomposed one after the other. Euler angle itself has several representations, we will see that later. The advantage of Euler angle is the fact that they represent a rotation with 3 angles, which is more meaningful than the 9 components of the matrix. However, Euler angles suffer from a defect called gimbal lock that makes this representation not so well suited for computation. The third representation is to define a rotation as a pair of axes and angle. The axis is a unit vector. It represents the axis around which the rotation takes place. And we associate to it the angle of rotation. Once again, this representation is easy to understand and represent. Possibly even more meaningful in 3D space than Euler angle. It has 4 components, but the axis is a unit vector, so we end up with 3 independent components spanning the degrees of freedom. Axis angle is, however, not easy to manipulate when composition between rotation have to be made. So it's interesting to store or represent rotation, but not so much directly for computation. And the last representation is the use of quaternions. So quaternions, Q, are 4D elements, X, Y, Z, W, and can be seen as being closely related to the axis angle representation, as the coordinates of Q are actually representing n times sinus theta divided by 2 and cosine theta divided by 2, which are the axis angle. Quaternion representation allows composition and even interpolation between rotation. It's well-suited representation to perform computation in the space of rotation. However, the components of a quaternion are less intuitive as they mix axis and angle together. One of the complexity of dealing with affine transform composition is that the order of operation does matter. For instance, if I have a rotation R and a translation T, rotation applied after translation is not the same than translation applied after rotation. So if we consider the matrix representation of these transforms, they do not commute. T times R is not R times T. And we can even check on the block matrix representation. So if you apply a translation and then a rotation, we end up with the rotation block and T as translation. And you can see the geometric results applied to this initially centered rectangle here. And if we apply rotation first and translation after, we end up this time with the same rotation block, but the final translation is R times T. And you can see in the right part that the rectangle has a different final position. This can also be understood by the fact that you first translated the object and the rotation afterwards always rotates around the origin. So it moves the object, which is now at a distance of the origin. And this is something that we tend to forget, actually. Linear operation, like rotation, always happen with respect to the origin and not with respect to some fixed point on the object. Also, beware that some libraries actually use an opposite convention in applying successive transformation from left to right, in a sense. Actually, they transpose the matrix before multiplying them. And this convention can sometimes look simpler, as all transformations are always applied with respect to the local coordinate of the shape. But it can make the mix of convention confusing, and these were used actually in old OpenGL version 1 and 2, and it's actually still in use with the JavaScript library 3.js, for instance. And now is some exercises that we will discuss during the interactive session. So a standard transform is to rotate a shape with a rotation r around a specific position P0 in space. So more precisely, it's around an axis defined by r that passes through P0. And the question is, how can I write this affine transform as a block matrix? The second question is now if I consider the triangular mesh with vertex position given as pi, how can I express the transformation that rotates this shape around its barycenter? A third question is if I consider an affine transform parameterized by a scaling s, a rotation r, and a translation t, and represented by a 4x4 matrix M. What would be the inverse transform representation, so the inverse matrix M minus 1, with respect to these parameters? And finally, let us first remind the transformation we apply typically in a vertex shader to render a shape. In a vertex shader, we often find three matrices applied to each vertex position that we send as uniform parameter from the main program to the GPU. They are respectively the model, the view, and the perspective matrix. So the model matrix actually represents the transformation which is applied to each individual object. Basically, it represents the transformation from the local shape coordinate to the world space. This matrix is usually attached to the shape, and in the lab class, this matrix is associated to the transform attached to the drawable shapes. The view matrix represents the position and orientation of the camera. Sometimes it's called the extrinsic parameter of the camera. So this matrix is applied to all the shapes of the scene so that you have the impression of seeing a motion from the point of view. But actually, it's a transform applied to all the shapes, and the rendered space, also called view space, is always the same. So remember that OpenGL only displays elements within a cube between minus 1 and plus 1 coordinates. So the view matrix actually transforms the world space coordinates into the view space, where the center of the camera is actually at the origin, and the right and up direction are actually x and y. And finally, there is the perspective matrix that models the intrinsic parameters of the camera. These are the parameters that do not depend on the position in space. This perspective matrix can represent the field of view, or the focal, the size of the screen, and model the change of length due to the depth of the object, unless it's an orthogonal projection. And so now the question is, given a camera placed in the world space and characterized by its central position, so the position of its focal point, and three unit vectors describing respectively its right, up and forward direction, what is actually the view matrix that need to be used in the shader? And so now we are going to have a look in more details at rotation representations. And as a reminder, rotation can be commonly represented either as matrix, Euler angle, axis angle, and quaternions. Let's us have a look on Euler angle. Euler angle consists in applying three consecutive basic rotations along some fixed orthogonal axis x, y, z. Each basic rotation can be parameterized and then we can compose them. Actually, there is two types of convention, the one called proper Euler angle, where we compose the rotation along z, then x, and then along the new z direction, or along x, y, and the new x direction, and so on and so on. And the second type is called Thread-Bryan representation, where we compose along three different directions, typically x, y, and then z, or z, y, and then x, and so on and so on. So actually, there is lots of possible convention in Euler angle, and take care that because different software can use different conventions, which can be confusing when exchanging data between different software. Sometimes the convention in use is not written explicitly. It's just said that it's Euler angle, and you have to figure out which one is actually used. So Euler angle have some advantage. Typically, it's a series of combination of rotation around known axis, and so the angle arguments are comprehensive from a human point of view. This is why Euler angle is often proposed in 3D modeling and animator interface. Animators are familiar to interact with angular curves. And you can also often find Euler angle conventions used in robotics too. But Euler angles have also limitation. The most critical one is the one called gimbal lock. Gimbal lock is a loss of 1 degree of freedom in specific configuration that actually depend on the convention we use. So to understand gimbal lock, we can have a look at the frames shown in the right. Each frame, actually the blue, green, and the one passing through the plane, correspond to a rotation around one of the axes X, Y, and Z. In normal configuration, rotating each frame brings a new degree of freedom. So we have 3 degrees of freedom, and this is a gimbal system. The gimbal locks arise when one axis is aligned with the other. So let's suppose the green axis is aligned with the blue one. So I fix 1 degree of freedom in this configuration. Then I should still have 2 independent parameters. However, rotating the blue frame in this configuration actually gives a rotation around the same axis than the third frame when rotating the plane. This implies that in this configuration, I have only 1 degree of freedom, the angle around the vertical direction, and not 2 as I would have expected. And this can be also understood in looking at the equations. We multiply the 3 rotation matrix around X, Y, and Z, and let's fix the second one to an angle of pi over 2. Then, if we develop the equation, we actually end up with the special configuration of sine and cosine relations, where the alpha and gamma are actually linked and end up in the sum of the angle along the z direction, which means that we have only 1 degree of freedom left. While Euler angles are still often used in animation software by artists, gimbal lock can happen, and as the frames are not necessarily showed, it's kind of strange to suddenly see a rotation somehow block. So real gimbal system actually need 4 axes to avoid this lock effect. And another point with Euler angle is that it can be actually used to interpolate rotation, and in this case we simply interpolate separately each angle. It works in the sense that the result is still a rotation that goes from the initial rotation to the target, but the trajectory followed by a rotation point may not be the simplest possible one. Third, there is the possibility to parameterize a rotation with an axis and an angle. Actually, any rotation can be fully described by a single unit axis and a scalar giving the angle. And this leads to 3 independent degrees of freedom. 2 for the unit axis and 1 for the angle. So this representation has the advantage of being relatively concise, and it expresses the 3 degrees of freedom with meaningful parameters. The axis always makes sense in the global coordinate system. And it's a representation in which we can simply express the rotation between 2 vectors. For instance, suppose you have 2 non-aligned unit vectors u1 and u2, and you look for rotation transforming u1 into u2. First, you can find easily a possible axis of this rotation, which is the one which is orthogonal to both u1 and u2. So you can compute it as the cross product between these 2 vectors. Then you can find the cosine of the angle of rotation as the dot product between u1 and u2. And so you have efficiently your parameters expressing this rotation. Note that this is not the only possible rotation. Actually, you have 1 degree of freedom left, which would be how much you twist around the U2. And this can be arbitrary. So if you apply this formula to an animated shape along a trajectory direction, for instance, you will have a correct alignment, but your shape may still turn up and down if you don't fix these extra degrees of freedom. So we have this parametrization, but can we compute the application of this rotation to a vector in this form? Actually, yes, and this is called the Rodrigues formula. So we are not going into the details, but we can demonstrate it geometrically in splitting the vector along the parallel and orthogonal component along the axis of rotation. So basically, the parallel component remains the same, while the orthogonal component is actually a 2D rotation in this orthogonal plane. And using a simple 2D rotation formulation, you can reach back the final expression giving the rotated coordinate as cos theta times v plus sin theta times the cross product between the rotation axis n and the vector v plus 1 minus cos theta, the triple cross product, which is v dot n times n. As a rotation is a linear operation, we can even express this formula as a matrix. To do so, we can expand each term, the cross product and the dot product, as their corresponding linear operation applied to the coordinate of v. Then, factorizing all the expression, we can find the full expression of the matrix to apply to v. Basically, the matrix is rather complex, and of course, this is not the thing that we should know from scratch, but this can be coded once, and then given a unit axis and an angle, you have the direct representation of this rotation as a matrix. And this parametrization is often more powerful and expressive than trying to describe your rotation with Euler angle, and it doesn't suffer from any bad configuration as the Euler angle. So as a summary, the axis angle representation is a concise representation with meaningful parameters, an axis and an angle. You have a direct correspondence between this parametrization and the matrix, and you can efficiently apply this rotation to a vector. It, however, has some limitations. First, there is no simple composition expression between two rotations with different axes, and you cannot directly interpolate rotation in this representation. So these limitations are actually solved by the quaternion representation. So the quaternions are the number q given by four parameters x, y, z, and w, and q is equals to xi plus yj plus zk plus w, with I, j, and k a basis of imaginary unit vector. We call w the real part and x, y, z the imaginary part or pure quaternion part. We can write q as a 4D vector, but beware that this should not be confounded or mixed with 4D vector in homogeneous coordinates. They don't follow the same rules and they don't represent the same thing. So quaternion can be seen as the generalization of complex numbers to 3D. While unit complex number represent rotation in 2D, unit quaternions represent rotation in 3D. So the properties of the quaternion can be expressed by the algebra applied to its basis vector a, j, and k. So the basic operation can be applied to quaternions, like its conjugate, q star, where the imaginary part is negated. The norm of a quaternion, which is the standard norm of a vector, and the product between quaternions. We can expand it using the relation of the basis vector, and we have this relatively complex relation. The quaternion product is associative, but it's not commutative, and which is actually expected, as is the case with rotation. So note that this product between quaternions can also be written more simply if we express the imaginary part xyz as a simple vector called s, and then the product q1, q2 can be expressed with a combination of S1 and S2 with their W parameter and their cross and dot products. So it's not obvious from the relation, but unit quaternion can actually represent the operation of rotation. To show this, we consider a unit quaternion Q and a vector XYZ. that we associate to a pure imaginary quaternion QV with coordinates given as x, y, z, and 0. Then we need to apply this operation, q, qv, q star, where q star is the conjugate of q. We can expand this operation with a specific parametrization of unit vector n and angle phi. I don't go into the details, but you can follow the demonstration on the slide if you want. And factorizing well the expression leads at the end to an expression that actually looks like Rodrigue's formula. So it means that applying this operation, q, qv, q star, actually perform a rotation on the coordinate of the vector associated to qv. And basically, identifying the terms together show that a unit quaternion q actually represents a rotation parameterized by an axis n and an angle theta. And the coordinate of q are given by n sine theta divided by 2 for the imaginary part, and w is cos theta divided by 2. Secondly, we can also show that the product of unit quaternions q1 times q2 corresponds to the composition of rotation r1 and r2. And there is also the demonstration on the slides if you wish to follow it. And finally, the unit quaternion can also be associated to its matrix coefficient. So this is the representation. Once again, the representation is not to be known, and its structure is of course similar to the one related to axis angle representation. But you can code it once for all, and you have the conversion between unit quaternion and matrix. Beware that your quaternion has to be of unit norm, otherwise this matrix representation would not make sense. And for the demonstration, we just expand the product q, qv, q star and factorize all the linear terms together. So as a summary, you have here a correspondence between the 3D vector matrix space and the quaternion space. So a vector in 3D space is xyz, while in quaternion space is the pure imaginary quaternion xyz0. A rotation transform in 3D space can be represented by its matrix, while it is a unit quaternion. To apply a rotation to a vector, it's the matrix times vector product in 3D, while in quaternion space, it's q times qv times q star, with qv being the vector part. And beware to not forget this last conjugate part, q star. It's not the simple product times q times qv. And rotation composition are similar. It's the matrix products on one side and quaternion product on the other. Also, a rotation of axis n and angle theta is described by the unit quaternion with coordinate n sine theta divided by 2 and cos theta divided by 2. And you can convert a unit quaternion to a matrix using this relation. And take care that all these formula actually only make sense for unit quaternions. And now we are going to see approaches used to interpolate rotations. We already saw interpolation of position, but in the case of rigid shapes, we also need to interpolate their orientations. So the problem is the following. Given two rotations, R1 and R2, find the rotation R of parameter t such that R of 0 equals R1 and R at times t equals 1 is equals to R2. So the naive approach is to apply a standard interpolation in each component of their respective matrix, R1 and R2. It's however not adapted for rotation matrix. Indeed, t times r1 plus 1 minus t times r2 is actually not a rotation anymore. Then you actually introduce scaling and shearing components. Actually, correct interpolation would relate to something called exponential map, allowing to follow a shortest path on the manifold. This would imply the computation of the exponential of matrices, which are actually complex to compute. In the case of Euler angle, you can interpolate the three angles separately and it works. So this time the result of an interpolation is a rotation, but in some cases the trajectory followed by the interpolation may not be the simplest possible one. In the case of axis angle, there is no direct trivial interpolation scheme when using different axes. And finally, the quaternion space is actually adapted for such interpolation. Quaternion space are 4D unit points. So the geometry of the space is a 4D sphere, which means that interpolating rotation is similar to interpolate points on a sphere, which is actually a simpler problem. First, we start with the so-called LIRP, the linear interpolation in quaternion space. We consider two quaternions, Q1 and Q2, both are on a 4D sphere, and schematically, I can display them on a 2D circle. So I can perform a linear interpolation in this space that leads to a point in between. And as this point doesn't have a unit norm, then I can normalize it afterwards. So this is the formulation. Q of t is equals to 1 minus t Q1 plus t times Q2. And then we normalize Q of t. So this is a very simple formulation. And it follows a geodesic on the sphere. Also a shorter path. It's actually a great circle on the 4D sphere. Which means that we are actually following the more logical path between the two rotations. And the other advantage of this representation is that we can use other interpolation schemes when dealing with more rotation. For instance, I can apply spline interpolation over some rotation Qi and in this space of quaternion. So I can interpolate smoothly between an arbitrary number of rotations. I can do barycenter, I can do hermit interpolation, and so on. The disadvantage of this simple method is that the angular speed of the interpolated orientation is not constant along t. And if we take two extreme opposite quaternion, then we will switch suddenly between one or the other. So the second and more correct approach is called SLURP, for spherical linear interpolation. So this method consists in correctly interpolating points on a unit sphere. And it works for points in any dimension, actually. So I can consider two very general vectors, V1 and V2, on a sphere. And I call omega the angle between V1 and V2. So I can find a vector V, which is parametrized by the angle theta, that I can write as t times omega, with t varying between 0 and 1. And this is the process of such spherical interpolation that can be expressed as this 2D representation. I skip the details, but we can express V geometrically as a function of V1, V2, omega, and t. Then we have the formulation that V of t equals sine of 1 minus t omega divided by sinus omega V1 plus sinus t omega divided by sinus omega V2. And as quaternions are points on a 4D sphere, we can directly apply this scheme to it. And we end up with this formulation to interpolate two quaternions, where V1 and V2 are the unit quaternion Q1 and Q2. The SLURP also has the advantage to follow a geodesic on the 4D sphere, but in addition to LIRP, it has a constant speed. So the orientation will rotate with a constant speed. However, in this case, we cannot simply generalize this formulation to more general curves. SLURP is restricted to be applied between two quaternions. And if we want to interpolate more orientation, then we should use LIRP simply. And as a final note, we should take care with quaternion sign and interpolation. Basically, plus quaternion and minus the quaternion correspond to the same rotation. Plus Q correspond to a rotation around an axis N and an angle theta, while minus Q correspond to a rotation around the axis minus N and the angle 2 pi minus theta, which actually ends up in the same configuration. So beware that if Q corresponds to the matrix R, then minus Q does not correspond to the matrix minus R. It's still plus R. And we can actually get tricked if we mix quaternion with matrices and vector using operator overloading in codes, for instance. And the second issue is that while plus Q and minus Q leads to the same rotation, the path that is followed between Q1 to Q2 is not the same than the path followed from Q1 to minus Q2. And we turn basically in opposite direction in the two different cases. And typically, there is one path which is actually shorter than the other. So if we simply apply a direct interpolation, we can end up with rotation that suddenly turned all the way around, like in this animation. So in practice, to avoid this, we should check the shorter path before applying the slurp. To check for the shorter path, we can look at the angle between Q1 and Q2, and Q1 and minus Q2, and pick the smaller one. Or in other words, we can check if the dot product between Q1 and Q2 is positive, and if not, we negate Q2. And now we will see finally how to interpolate affine transforms. So one common need is to interpolate rigid motion. Typically, 3D shapes have an orientation and a position P, so we need to interpolate both. It's common to handle position and orientation separately. So given two key positions, defined by a position P1 and a rotation R1, as well as P2 and R2, we can compute the in-between at time t belonging between 0 and 1, in first computing the linear interpolation of position, so P of t equals 1 minus t P1 plus t times P2, and applying a slurp or a lerp on the rotation. So for that, we need to convert R1 and R2 into the corresponding quaternions, Q1 and Q2. Then we compute Q of t as the slurp of Q1 and Q2 at time t. And finally, we convert Q of t back in its representation of our rotation, typically in matrix form. And we can see such interpolation in computing an interpolated frame between two extreme ones. And we can see that both position and orientation are smoothly varying. And we can compare three different interpolations between these two extreme frames. On the left, there is a linear interpolation applied to the components of the rotation matrix. And as the frame have opposite direction, the interpolation passes by a singularity in the middle and have a very strong scaling artifact. Euler angle interpolation and quaternion interpolation looks better. If we look carefully, we can actually see that the trajectory followed by the extremity are planar in the case of quaternions, while they are arbitrary 3D trajectory when using Euler angle. And finally, we can discuss the case where the input is given as a generic matrix. In some cases, you won't have access directly to rotation, translation, and scaling well stored separately, but you will only have a generic 4x4 matrix as input. So the question is, given two 4x4 matrices, how can I interpolate between them? So for that, we need to extract the different components separately to apply separate interpolation. Extracting the translation from the matrix is easy. We can directly take the top right coordinates. The top left block corresponds to the linear part is actually less easy. It can mix rotation as well as scaling and shearing. So we cannot directly convert this matrix to a quaternion. And the idea is to split the rotation part from the scaling and shearing part. And one of the possible approaches is called the polar decomposition. So the polar decomposition of a matrix M consists in constructing two matrices, R and D, such that M is equal to R times D, with R being an orthogonal matrix, so it's a rotation, and D is a positive semi-definite matrix, and it contains both the scaling and the shearing. To compute the polar decomposition of M, we can use the SVD decomposition. SVD gives us three matrices, W, sigma, and V, and the orthogonal matrix can be computed as W times V transpose, while D is V times sigma times V transpose. And you can check that the product between R and D gives you M. Another way to compute this decomposition is to use an iterative scheme where we initialize R0 to M and then we iteratively compute RA plus 1 to be equals to 0.5 times R of I plus R of I inverse transpose. Indeed, we can check that when we have rotation, R transpose is equals to R inverse and this scheme remains stable. So this is the final algorithm given two 4x4 matrix, M1 and M2. First, we extract the translation part P1 and P2 from M1 and M2. Then we compute the 3x3 rotation matrix and D1 and D2, the scaling and shearing matrices from M1 and M2 using the polar decomposition. Third, we can perform the linear interpolation on the position, as well as on the scaling and shearing matrix. And for them, component-wise interpolation works fine. Fourth, we can compute the quaternion Q1 and Q2 from the rotation matrix R1 and R2. And here's the formula I didn't give you previously. It's how to convert a rotation matrix to its quaternion. And you can use this relation, although depending on the case, some are numerically more stable than others. Then fifth, you can compute the interpolated quaternion with slurp, and then convert back the interpolated quaternion to its matrix. And finally, assemble the final matrices together with M of T is equals to R of T times D of T, and plug back the translation P of T in it. And you have your interpolated matrix.